You are listening to a Clarkesworld Magazine podcast with your host and narrator, Kate Baker. Greetings, Clarkesworld citizens. I hope this podcast finds you well. Welcome to October 2023, issue 205. So tell me, is this your first story here at Clarkesworld? Or is it close to 1,000? Or maybe somewhere in the middle? Whether it's your first or you've been here a while, I want to thank you for coming by and showing your support. If you'd like to contribute financially to the magazine, as Amazon has completely screwed up a lot of different income things for us, please consider going to patreon.com/Clarkesworld. Your support matters so greatly to us. We depend on it to put out these magazines each and every month. So our first story is titled Possibly Just About a Couch and is by Suzanne Palmer. And I know that if you have been here for a while, you know all about Suzanne Palmer. Suzanne Palmer has brought you stories to Sail Beyond the Botnet, The Sadness Box, Plots of the Lost Ark, Dave's Head, and The Painter of Trees. Suzanne is a writer and occasional artist who lives in Western Massachusetts with too many two- and four-legged creatures and a new gray couch because her Irish wolfhound, Tolkien, acting in his capacity of an agent of chaos and entropy, ate the last one. So, my dear listener, I hope you can sit back, relax, and let me tell you a story. The universe begins. It has barely begun to stretch out and wiggle its toes into the void, having just settled the primary matter of whether it will be one of positrons or electrons. Electrons wins out this time, though only by a hair, when the couch appears. Probably this couch is a metaphor, though those have not yet formally been invented, if by invented you mean named, though those are not the same thing at all. Energy spins to matter, matter spins to dust, dust spins, coalesces, and should probably cling to the nascent bright red thing, but the couch is wholly ambivalent about gravity, so the dust ignores it, as it always has and very likely always will. Instead, the particles pull together with their neighbors, growing and solidifying and passing word, "We are here, over here." Only the best dust given membership here. Until, like a group chat gone rogue and running over its moderation, the very first to cross the point of no return collapses into itself, and in the ensuing heat and drama becomes a star. Ever chasing trends, more stars follow. Dust clouds whirl with light and competition until some star says, "Hey, I have a truly groovy fashion concept," and then planets are born to adorn them, and that is where the couch first sets its feet upon something solid. There's no reason it had to be the only one, but it was. If anyone had thought to speculate if other couches existed, unseen deep within the hearts of stars, occluded inside some planet's mantle, or far out in places of void where light had not yet and might never reach, it certainly could have been possible. Or at least no more impossible. But as it happens, there is just the one. If it is because the margin between electrons and positrons was too narrow, too fraught with that initial uncertainty to allow more, that sort of supposition in service to the subject of the mysterious couch population would be inescapably silly. So, this couch. It's red. Has that been told already? A brilliant scarlet that is almost an unseemly hue. If one can assign moral value to a wavelength of light, which seems specious at best. Is the color hinting at some fundamental impropriety, hidden secrets, or the possibility of wild, dangerous adventure? Or is it as random as everything else, a great house of cards, happenstance upon chance upon that perpetual foundation of fortune and misfortune? It is soft, but not unfirm. It is comfortable, possibly even cozy, but not unnaturally so. It abides. And the universe marches on. Lava, lava, more lava, then an errant planetlet crashes the party and vaporizes all the hard work already done, forcing the planet to scrap its plans and start over. Of course, that means more lava, a standard party favor as all the cataclysmic forces battle on a monumental no-holds-barred scale. Still, the couch is untouched. Left either to float atop the magma oceans or ride unbothered whatever surface forms there. Raindrops fall, may settle briefly upon its cushions, but it is not permeable, and the water soon runs off and away again into the cooling rock. Elements come and go. Poor Afanium, briefly a sensation, last seen slinking off in the night, never to be seen again. Continents crash and split, and when the couch's plate dives, grumbling beneath another, the couch simply stays where it is and lets the new plate slide into place under its stout, stubby feet. That means the couch sits atop ocean, briefly, or for an extended epoch. It does not show any indication of minding whatsoever. Possibly, because it's just a couch. Sponges grow on its lower edges, then evolve and go elsewhere. Bugs arise and fly overhead in monstrous, glorious, shimmering wings, and ferns delight in the couch's small shade until the ice comes, not returning until it finally retreats again. For a long time, a boulder, a glacial erratic even, not just some random rock off the streets, but something entitled to a name of its own, is nestled against the left arm of the couch where it had been pushed by the ice and then found it could not be pushed any further. The erratic has weathered down to a cracked, pitted thing by the time Eoraptor decides that the couch is a perfect place for her nest and her eggs, and stays a while. It is gone by the time a Torvosaurus, chasing its next meal, trips over the couch and falls into the rock-strewn mud beyond, breaking its neck and turning slowly into one more tragic fossil. Birds come and flowers, and tiny mammals scurry underneath the couch for shelter. Eventually, there are people, assuming birds and bugs and ferns and Eoraptors don't count, which is highly debatable. But for some reason, most do not find the bright red inviting. See above. Regarding hints of wild, dangerous adventure, which are not very attractive to species barely clinging to their own existence, Homo habilis, particularly, invariably runs at the sight of it, which is unfortunate because they definitely could have benefited from a brief respite to just relax and chill for a bit. Homo erectus tries to stab it, then bite it, then set it on fire, but still will not just sit. Plates continue to move, continents continue to go sightseeing across the face of the planet. Eventually, a village grows up near the couch and around it. For a while, it is inside a castle, then inside a castle wall, then perched brightly among ruins. We will not mention at all its brief but undignified time in a midden. When Ned rents the house that eventually contains it, he believes it was put there by the landlord, because the previous tenants were certainly not the types to keep any piece of furniture clean and in good repair. He and Shannon have sex on it more than once. Ned also tries to have sex on it with Dean, who rents a room upstairs, but the couch freaks Dean out and he tries to invite Ned back up to his place instead. Ned calls him a superstitious caveman. Maybe he and Homo habilis were onto something, maybe not. And that's the end of that. The next renters burn the house down, and the couch sits there in the rubble for a while, waiting for insurance adjusters, who are not much faster in action than the various glaciers who have crept by, and will again in the future. If the couch has an opinion, which it does not, it would think the glaciers superior because at least they arrived with interesting megafauna instead of clipboards. The house is rebuilt, remodeled, and no one seems to wonder why this couch is there, still looking not one day older than the beginning of the universe itself, though more than one person finds it frustratingly impossible to move, even a few inches, even as a team effort. Even with the assistance of alcohol and cursing. Mostly, though, no one thinks to move it, as if it is where it properly belongs. Carla crochets a beautiful rainbow throw for it, and it suits it beautifully. She spends many years with it, reading books, knitting, and crocheting, laughing or crying with friends who are never as stalwartly companionable as the couch, which she has come to think of as hers. When she sells the house, she regrets having to leave it behind, but her movers can't budge it. It feels like it's proper for it to remain where it is. She kisses it goodbye and leaves it the now worn throw, which the new homeowners immediately bag up and throw away. Eventually, bombs happen, and there is no house again, nor any mud to make fossils of the people who tried desperately to hide behind it. It is a long time before archaeologists come and find it and are amazed by such a perfectly preserved artifact. In the end, they build their museum around it and showcase it next to their other treasures. Three frisbees, a braille copy of Moby Dick, a cappuccino machine that they theorize dispensed some sort of cure-all, and three quarters of the very first android, reconstructed but not functional, with a do not sit sign. Or more accurately, a Fenachi Buchenhem sign on the couch right where Carly used to rest her basket of yarn. Most visitors to the museum respect the sign, not of any lawful inclinations, but maybe because Homo Pertinax received more from his ancestors than just a wackily hazardous climate, mottled pockets of radiation, and a fondness for cheese. The rare alien visitor, though, inevitably ignores the sign and sits, perches, slithers, alights, condenses, apparates, lies upon it, and has to be chased off by whatever docent spots the infectious guest. By the time the sun senesces enough to reach out, an ice age made of fire that rolls over its planetary erratics one by one until it wraps itself around Earth, the museum and anyone left to visit it are already long gone. If the couch minds eventually being left adrift in the dying remains of the star system, who would know? Galaxies collide and pull each other apart, and a new galaxy claims the couch for a while, though it never does manage to settle a planet under it, or let it shade and shelter ferns again. There are three visitors to the couch, which, if you think about how mind-numbingly vast space is, how a tiny couch floating all alone in it is pretty damn good. Not that any of them sit. The universe continues to expand outward, thinning as it goes, matter being of finite supply. Eventually, any aberration in the nothingness is well within statistical error, and all is dark and cold and forgotten for a very long time. She is also probably a metaphor, although it's also possible that she's the only thing that's not, comes along and finds a sofa and sits for a bit, though she is mostly immaterial and mostly far too ethereal and limitless for sitting to have much meaning. She can smell the long-ago scent of Eoraptor's eggs, like chalk and faint juniper, and she can feel the ghost of Carla's colorful throw warm on her neck, though she has no neck. No need, or concept of one. She can feel the hot creep of lava, the warm touch of living earth, the gentle scratchings of coral and sponge, and the tiny nibbles of fishes. She can sense the imprint of Ned's ass, where he sat alone and pouted about Dean for an overindulgent number of days, though it let Shannon get free of him, which was all for the better. She can hear the pipes playing off the walls of the castle, hear the low thrum of dragonfly wings. Feel a flutter of butterflies rewrite history around them in immeasurable ways. She can feel the swell of oceans and hear the echoes of plesiosaurs and nautili and whales singing songs of love and friendship from below. Everything that is or was is perfectly remembered. At last, she digs down among the cushions, rummaging between them, until she finds that one infinitely small, infinitely dense grain of existence, no more than a glimmer, a fleck of glitter, waiting. She holds it in her palm that is not a palm, feels the heat and potential and impatience of it, and then blows on it gently as if it were an ember to ignite. Memories of fear, the crush of destruction and desolation, the emptiness and entropy are stripped away with that breath. But hope and wonder and joy remain, for information is never, ever truly lost. And those last are the most fundamental of all. New decisions will need to be made, will always be made again and again. But so it is meant to be. She lets the spark go, sees it touch the void around it, and desires to make it full again, to wiggle its toes in the future, always a future. "Let there be life," she says. And with those words, the universe begins. What are your thoughts on the story? You can leave us a comment if you go to the Clarkesworld Magazine About Us page. All of our contact information is listed there. We love getting emails from you, letting us know how you're enjoying the stories, what you do when you're listening to them, all the good stuff. We have a new slate of stories yet to come for October, so please come back and listen. And until then, my dear listener, I bid you a very fond and hopefully very temporary farewell.